I, Jimmy Carter, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States.
Our commitment to human rights must be absolute. Our laws fair, our natural beauty preserved. The powerful must not persecute the weak, and human dignity must be enhanced.
As his first public act as president, on his way to the White House, Jimmy Carter startled onlookers when he and his family left their motorcade and proceeded on foot down Pennsylvania Avenue. Once in office, Jimmy Carter brought a sense of high moral purpose to the presidency. He appointed more women, blacks, and Hispanics to government jobs than any previous president.
I'm very glad to sign now House Resolution 4876 that provides opportunities for the American people to go back to work.
Faced with rising inflation and unemployment, he still was able to add 8 million jobs and bring down the budget deficit.
I urge you to support the strong defense budget which I have proposed to the Congress.
At the same time, he raised defense spending for the first time since the Vietnam War, defying the liberal wing of his own party. Further, he modernized defense by opting for more forward-looking programs, such as stealth aircraft and state-of-the-art missiles, over more expensive conventional weapons. History has proved him correct. Carter's administration saw other major achievements: a new Department of Education, as well as a new Department of Energy.
Yesterday, the Department of Energy was created.
Along with the nation's first comprehensive energy policy, he expanded the national park system, including the protection of 103 million acres of Alaskan wilderness.
In support of human rights, the United States will stand firm.
In foreign policy, he introduced human rights as a major issue in international relationships. He negotiated the Panama Canal Treaty, which restored sovereignty and complete control of the canal zone to Panamanians. Continuing the efforts of previous presidents, Carter succeeded in restoring full diplomatic relations with China and signed a significant Strategic Arms Limitations Talks, or SALT II agreement, with the Soviet Union. But his finest hour was the Camp David peace accords between Israel and Egypt.
I saw that Holy Land region as a potential explosive point that might have brought about a superpower war. After the first 3 days, the two men, Begin and Sadat, were so completely and personally incompatible, they couldn't even be in the same room without exploding in anger. So I kept them apart. They never saw each other for 10 days, and I went back and forth. But I learned about what was special in their hopes and dreams and aspirations, their background, their obligations, their previous commitments. And so I was able finally to enmesh the two in a reasonable agreement that I think was very beneficial for both Israel and for Egypt.
Let us have three of us together.
Very good.
The result was a treaty that endures to this day.
I'm so proud of both of you.
Crises dogged the last part of Carter's administration. An energy and gas shortage resulted from revolutionary upheavals in Iran. Pressure on domestic supplies of oil and gas led to long lines at the gasoline pumps. Finally, Iran seized the U.S. Embassy in Tehran and held 52 Americans hostage for the last 444 days of the Carter administration.
We're using every available channel to protect the safety of the hostages and to secure their release.
Carter's intense negotiations for their safety and freedom continued daily, but it was not enough to save his re-election. Only minutes after he officially left office, the hostages were released.
And every one of the 52 hostages was alive, was well, and free.